Now I have the pleasure to welcome a very, very special person, Ajinkya Hange. Just give me one moment. And Ajinkya, we're just waiting for you to come on the screen. I'm just waiting for Ajinkya. So.
Ma'am, he's there.
Give me a moment. You know, I wanted to make a very special introduction. Ajinkya is here. Yes. Oh, wonderful. So good to see you, Ajinkya. And we are streaming Ajinkya live on Facebook on many platforms. And more importantly, we are streaming him live right from his farm. Okay. So there were many, many people on our network who were constantly asking us, okay, you have showed us all this, but we have many questions about how do we really do it? How do we really go about doing it? Where do we start? What next? How does it look like? How do we plan our crops, etc.? So we said there couldn't be anybody better than Ajinkya himself, who has demonstrated how to create a very, very successful natural farm and make it, it's truly a model of successful natural farming and farm to fork, which Ajinkya and his brother Satyajit, the two co-owners of two brothers farm. So now they are, incidentally, the latest news is that it's no longer two brothers. Now they are really a family, because they have made many of the persons working in their farm also, stakeholders in the farm. It's a new model which they have created. We'll get to know more about it. But as of now, I'm going to have it over to Ajinkya to share a little more about his journey of how he got into farming. Both the brothers were very successful in their corporate careers. They had a family farm in a small village of Maharashtra, but they decided that they want to come back from the corporate world, very successful corporate people from Hong Kong Bank, Citibank, etc. And they decided, no, we want to really do something for the biodiversity of, in Maharashtra, and come down to exploring this piece which was left behind. So, Ajinkya, very keen to know how you started this and where are you exactly in Maharashtra right now?
Super. Good afternoon to everybody. Thanks for having us over. Our farm is 150 kilometers south of Pune. It's in a town called Indapur and the village name is Bhodni. It's a 21-acre farm. It's an organic farm, a natural farm, a biodiverse, a multi-cropping system of farming that we follow. And the heart of the farm are the cows that we have. It's all indigenous cows. We use their dung, the urine as manure, as the only fertilizer on the soil. The cows form the heart of our farm. And on the farming side, we're growing close to, we started off with the 5 and 6 crop varieties. Then we moved on to 15, 20 varieties. Now we plant, I think, close to 20, 25 different crops at the farm. So me and my brother Satyajit, we together run this farm. It's been, farming has been that one thing that we've always wanted to do. It took us time to reach from 2012 that we ran, full time. Yes.
Okay, wonderful. And yeah, so Satyajit, unfortunately, has not joined us today, but Ajinkya is going to make up. How many cows, buffaloes, bulls do you have on your farm?
So we started with the 4 cows, 4 indigenous Gir cows. And then from a 4 cows, we've now, today, 8 years down the line, it's close to around 70, 80 cows that we have at the farm. We use the cow dung, the cow urine, as slurry on the soil. And that's the only input. So our objective of having them on the farm is purely for their manure. Yeah.
Okay, so they are not, but you're also doing dairy, right, Ajinkya, if I'm not mistaken?
Yeah, so when we started in 2012, we had bought calves at the farm because a cow that does not milk, its quality of dung and urine is said to be better. So in 2012, when we got the cows, they were not milking. When the calf turned into cows 3-4 years down the line, that's close to around 2016, that's when we had excess milk coming to us. And so we started converting our excess milk into ghee. So, you know, that's been the journey. You know, actually, the journey has been in two parts. One is coming to do farming. That's been one journey in itself. And then the different experiments we did at farming, we did with the farms, and then making the farm sustainable. So, yeah.
So you did share with me the other day that, you know, there were a lot of challenges you faced, and it wasn't as if it was successful from day one. We definitely like to know what are the challenges you faced and what mistakes you make, so that we don't make, you know, some of our viewers don't make those mistakes. And secondly, what was the journey where it actually changed for you? I mean, what was the tipping point, so to speak, where, and today you're not just successful, you're super successful. I almost see this as a, you know, model for many others to follow. So what was that tipping point? And also something about why you made the decision to go for natural farming. I mean, ye pushtani jaidat tha aapka, aur aap isko chemical farming bhi kar sakte the aur paisa bana sakte the. But what made you actually, you know, take a decision to do natural farming?
Yeah, so to start from the beginning, we were born to a farmer's family. Our father is a farmer, generation farmers. But we were put in a boarding school in Pune right from the age of 4 years old. Right from kindergarten till we went out to do our MBAs. So we only visited the farms in the holidays, in the summer holidays when we came to the village. Otherwise, we were kept as far as possible away from the farms. Even education-wise, we never got an agri or we never did a degree or any education in agri, no BSc or MSc agri. But yeah, when we finished our MBAs, we started working out with different companies. And we started paying attention back at the farm as to what has been growing. And we had been seeing, you know, being farmers' children, having spent our childhood at the farms, we had always been observing. We used to have sugarcane as a crop at the farms. And we had been observing that a 1 acre of sugarcane, which gave us 80 tons of output yearly, was dropping from 80 tons to a 60 tons to a 50 tons. Input costs were increasing. So it all started with, why is this happening? I mean, why is a sugarcane productivity, which when we were small 15, 20 years back, easily could give 70, 80 tons of sugarcane, and now it's dropped down so drastically. So it started with a small study as to why and how this is happening. And then very, very soon we understood that, you know, it's not about sugarcane or it's not about a particular crop, but as a farmer, it is about growing your soil. The soil is the main component in farming. So it's not about which crop, which fruit, which pulse, which biodiverse food, forest. I mean, you could grow anything. You could grow different crops. But the one thing as a farmer over a long period of time that you need to grow is the soil and the fertility of the soil. So your question was, how did we arrive at changing our model in farming? So once we understood that soil is the main heart or the main component of farming, it was clear that applying chemicals to the soil was the last thing you could do, because then you're killing the biology in the soil. So, I mean, just for information's sake, soil is not just your, you know, mud and stones and twigs. It's about the microorganisms that stay in the soil, and that is what increases the soil fertility. So, immediately we turned our model from the existing model that we had. We stopped applying chemicals. We stopped applying any insecticides, pesticides. It is also clear to us that if you want to increase soil fertility, one of the best inoculation of bacteria you can give the soil are the desi cows, cow dung, cow urine. So that's how we started, by buying indigenous cows and then using the dung and urine as slurry on the soil. And we turned the model entirely from being a chemical farm to being an organic farm. But a couple of practices, not just one or two, a couple of things helped us to go organic. While cows was one of them, concentrating on soil was one of them. I also think what was more important than, more...
We just lost your audio. Yeah.
The seed variety that you keep at the farms, that you grow at the farms. So the seeds that you're planting, we shifted to a purely... desi indigenous variety of seeds at the farms. So yeah, it was a combination of all this. So coming to your question.
I'm getting curiouser and curiouser, so to speak, and I'm sure some of our listeners also are. What I wanted to understand is that, you know, you came to some very intelligent choices. आपने बहुत intelligent choices करे कि soil हमें ठीक करना है उसमें, क्योंकि microbes अच्छे होने चाहिए और अच्छे होंगे, soil अच्छा होगा तो फिर खाना automatically अच्छा होगा. वो एक बहुत intelligent choice था. उसी तरह आपने बीज के बारे में बोला कि बीज कैसे होने चाहिए. जितने लोग मैं जानती हूँ जो farming में आते हैं, वो लोग ये सब चीजें कुछ कोई गुरुओं से सुनते हैं या किसी से जो इंस्पायर उनको करता है, या पालेकर जी हुए या भरत भूषण त्यागी जी हुए, दीपक सचदेव हुए, या हमारे कई कई डॉक्टर वेंकट हुए हैं, यू नो, सॉइल को लेके. अभी रतन लाल जी को बहुत बड़ा अवार्ड मिला है. तो कई कई ऐसे रह चुके हैं हमारे देश में. आपके कौन गुरु थे और आपने जो इतने इंटेलिजेंट चॉइसेस किए हैं, ये कैसे इंटेलिजेंट चॉइसेस मिले? किसी ने तो आपको समझाया होगा, कुछ बताया होगा कि आपने खुद इसको चीज समझ लिया, क्योंकि आप पढ़े लिखे थे इसलिए.
करेक्ट. सो इफ यू आस्किंग फॉर दैट वन गुरु, देयर वाज नो वन गुरु. इट वाज अ ग्रेजुअल प्रोसेस. सो व्हेन वी स्टार्टेड स्टडीइंग अबाउट, लाइक आई सेड, अबाउट शुगरकेन प्रोडक्टिविटी ड्रॉपिंग डाउन, वी केम टू द कंक्लूजन दैट दिस इज ऑल अबाउट सॉइल. You know, but farming as a whole was so interesting to us, even in terms of asking questions or as a study or as academics. So, you know, and when you're farming, you're studying about biology in the soil, you're studying about chemistry of different chemicals, you're studying about rainfall, you're studying about nature, you're studying about seeds, you're studying about animal and taking care of them. You're studying about, I mean, there are so many subjects involved in farming. That, you know, we came to a conclusion that farming is that one subject where all your other subjects culminate into. So, you know, learning from whom? So we started visiting farmers, and I think this is the most practical way you can go about it. We visited farmers, organic farmers across Gujarat, Maharashtra, Karnataka. Not many, many farmers, a few farmers. You know, it could have been all put together just a 10, 12 good farmers. But that kind of gave us clarity. Also, while we were visiting farms, we were sitting with farmers, understanding the growing processes, how they take care of insects, pests, what is the variety of seed they've grown. You know, are they, as a model, are they economically sustainable? Where do they sell their produce? So all of these things. And while this was happening, while practical visits were happening, we were also looking at, you know, material, looking at content on the internet, listening to different soil microbiologists, watching different videos about other successful farmers. So I think it was there was no one guru, but there was one farmer in Fultan, which is in Maharashtra, close to Satara. His name was Ashok Ingole, and he had close to around 120 killer cows. He was growing pomegranates. He was not using chemicals on the soil while he was using chemicals to spray on the crop. But that was one visit which gave us, you know, helped us to take the decision that, no, this is it. This is a model we need to now boil down to. This is the practices we need to now follow the farms. And so it's been a learning, you know, across, it's been a study of all that happens at the farm by visiting farmers, by reading books, by reading content on the internet. So it's been there's not been one single guru. It's been a combination of all of this khichdi.
सारे इतने सारे गुरु थे और सच में यही तरीका है फार्मिंग सीखने का, जहाँ जो जो फार्मर्स जो ये सब करते हैं उनसे जाके सीखना, यू नो, गोइंग देयर ऑन द ग्राउंड एंड लर्निंग. हम आपको एक शॉर्टकट दे रहे हैं कुछ कुछ लोगों से मिलाने का, लेकिन सच में वही एक तरीका है, बढ़िया तरीका है. सो अजिंक्य, मेनी पीपल हियर वुड वॉन्ट टू सी योर फार्म, दैट हाउ डू यू प्लान योर क्रॉप, हाउ डू यू रियली गो अबाउट इम्प्रूविंग द सॉइल क्वालिटी, वॉट डू यू यू नो वॉट आर द रियल स्टेप्स विच यू टेक टू बी a successful farmer. Yeah.
Correct. So, you know, we've over a period of time, from when we started farming, we've broken them into 4 or 5 pillars. The first being the soil, you know, concentrating on the soil. So, you know, it comes to soil biology, it comes to using only the indigenous, the desi cows, cow dung, cow urine. That is one practice that we follow. A second practice that we follow is we do a lot of mulching or a lot of composting or a lot of soil covers on the farm, on the soil. as far as possible, we do not leave the soil vacant. We cover it up with mulching, whether it's live mulching, it's dead mulching. That is the second practice that we follow. A third one that we do is we are practicing a lot of intercropping. So we do not do monocultures, we do not do monocropping, we avoid that. So while the first practice was the indigenous cows, cowden cowrie, and second being using a lot of soil in terms of mulching, the practice that we do, I can rotate my camera.
क्या मल्चिंग आप दिखा सकते हैं अभी अजिंक्य? Is there possible to?
Yeah, I'm just walking towards it. A fourth practice towards the mulching and all. A fourth practice that we so I'll just encapsulate the practices and then I'll show you each practice in detail.
Okay.
And a fourth practice is this compound trees that we have at the farm, which grow tall, which cut winds. So just 3 years back, this road at the farm was a vacant road, but now we've planted all these trees. And they kind of cut the winds. They help us to create a microclimate in the farm. These four practices, the desi cow's dung, cow urine, composting or mulching being the second, third being a lot of intercropping, fourth being a lot of compound trees. And beyond these four, the most important that we look at is planting the indigenous seed variety. So, most of your problems as a farmer can get solved if your problems like pest management, insect management, productivity, nutrition for the when the consumer's consuming it, something which has more nutrition, which is more medicinal, are crops that are indigenous in nature. So sure. After these four practices, we made sure that whatever you're planting was of an indigenous variety, was desi in nature, was not hybrid, was not advanced variety. And so I think these four or five practices is what we've concluded down to. Also, the choice of crops that you make as a farmer while farming is very important. So when we started out, there were a lot of crops that required a lot of water, like sugarcane, like bananas, and we come from a drought-prone area. It's mostly irrigated irrigation that happens here. So then we shifted our cropping pattern from crops that consume a lot of water to crops that are hardy, which require less water. So our experiment started with this plot. I'll start from here. So this is a pomegranate orchard that we have, which we've intercropped with drumsticks. This is a drumstick tree. And in this entire line is pomegranates.
Achha.
Like I said, our main emphasis is always on the soil. So
this is all the mulch. I can see.
Yeah, so as far as possible, we just keep the soil covered. We don't let it be exposed to the sunlight. Now, this is mulch and soil. If I pull the mulch aside, you can see a lot of life. So even if it's centipedes, millipedes, ants, there's a lot of soil, there's a lot of life in this.
Excellent. I'm waiting for the earthworms.
This is snails.
Okay, wonderful. So this is giving us a glimpse of what is pest management all about in a way. So at one end, you're working on the soil. On the other end, what are all these are considered pests by many people. So tell us a little more about that.
No, so these are not really pests. See, you need these creatures to aerate your soil. Your soil needs to be aerated. It needs to breathe. And these creatures do it for you. So even if you go deep inside, it's life everywhere. And the food for these creatures is nothing but this mulch that I've put on the top, what we call as organic matter.
Mm-hmm.
So, now soil is that one thing at the farm which has a solution to a lot of problems. Like I said, multi-cropping we're doing between this pomegranate and this is a drumstick tree. So we all know how soil biology works. any plant, you know, through photosynthesis produces chlorophyll, and whatever chlorophyll it produces, close to 60% of it, it pushes back into the soil through its roots in the form of carbohydrates and sugars. To eat that, you first have the bacteria coming in, you have the nematodes coming in, and then to eat them, you have protozoa coming in, and then the entire nutrient life cycle in the plant starts happening. No, these are organisms which we cannot see, but what we can then see is all these ants, centipedes, millipedes, different types of creatures. You know, it's all of this, and this is what increases soil fertility. This is what releases the nutrition from the soil, the nutrients which the plant uptakes. So yeah, like I said, you know, as a farmer, if you can move your, if you can get your soil fertile, that's one of the best things you can do. You know, even this white fungus that's developing, this thing out here is mycorrhiza fungi. It's all over the farm. So all these just help you or help your plants to take the nutrition, uptake the nutrition in a better way. Hello.
Anji, yes.
Yeah. Also, soils have a lot of solutions to the macro problems that a farmer faces. You know, in our area, or if you look at any drought-prone area, one of the problems that a farmer faces is water management. You know, whatever you save or whatever you earn in a 4-5 years of farming as a farmer really gets back into creating resources for water management. It could be a pond, it could be a well, it could be bore wells, and it's a costly affair. And all your profits, all that you've earned in the past 2, 3, 4 years really gets back into just creating those resources. Now, one of the best harvesters of water is again your soil. When your soil is fertile, when your soil is it's aerated well, when you have a lot of microorganisms, micro creatures working in the soil, automatically the soil turns porous. And when it rains, all the water seeps through these aerated channels back into the ground. And groundwater is, you know, that is the actual solution to your water harvesting. So soils are also the best harvesters of water. You know, also when it rains excess, it is good. When it does not rain excess, you can retain the moisture with whatever drip irrigation that you're doing in the soil for a longer period of time when it's aerated well.
So
that is one.
I wanted to understand.
Yeah, so even if you look at...
Sorry, please go ahead. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, even if you look at more global problems, you know, people talking of global warming, you know, that's when carbon is released into the atmosphere, that overheats the earth, that's what, you know, acidifies oceans, it destroys marine life. It's all because carbon, which is your mulch, which is all your, you know, this what I showed you all, that gets released into the atmosphere. And your soils, like I said, soil is the best, one of the best water harvesters. Similarly, soils is also, they can also sequester all your carbon back into the soil. Like I just said, you know, with photosynthesis, these crops take in all the carbon dioxide, and this carbon dioxide is what they push back into the soil in the form of sugars, carbohydrates. So your atmospheric carbon actually gets back into the soil and becomes soil carbon, which is also your, the best solutions you have for global warming. Am I growing or farming?
Absolutely.
But problems like global warming, it's not a boardroom or a corporate room problem. It's something which a farmer can very well fix. Yeah. So
what I also see you have done here in your farm is that you have a lot of trees along with crops. Now, whenever you go to the average farm I go to, it does not have so many trees, or it has trees in one small corner somewhere and the rest is all crops. It could be multi-crops or monocrops, but they're all crops. So have you managed to intersperse these two well? And I think that itself is a huge one for water conservation as well as richer soil.
Correct. So I'll just come to that. While I'm here, I'll show you, like I said, the four pillars that we follow. So number one is soil. Number two is mulching. Mulching, we make sure that we put whatever twigs, whatever leaves, dried leaves, whatever we have fallen on the farm. Even when we do weeding, we do not remove all this weeding out of the farm. We keep it back. We lay it back at the soil. So mulching is the second practice that we follow. Now mulching, you know, you can have two types. Either you can have since our area is a sugarcane belt, we have a lot of dried leaves of sugarcane that farmers burn. Now again, that is also a problem with farmers, especially in Delhi where the airports are shut down because of the the mulch burns in Punjab also. So any farmer who's burning it down, we go, we take it, we take the mulch from him, keep it outside our farms for 5-6 months, and whenever possible we keep applying it back to the soil. But this is dead mulching. The best form of mulching you can actually have is live mulching. So you know, you have your main crop as, let's say, if it's pomegranate, you grow, like we've grown drumstick out here. These drumstick leaves, you know, these drumstick leaves, when they dry, they'll fall back to the soil. And,
your video isn't moving, Ajinkya. Can you just check your network? Yeah, now we can see.
Yeah, is it moving now?
Now it is, yes.
Yeah. So I said the best form of mulching is to actually have intercrops. Like out here, we've intercropped drumstick, a drumstick tree with pomegranates. So now this drumstick tree's leaves, their twigs, when they dry, they get back, they fall back into the soil. And that becomes the natural organic matter, you know, for the microorganisms. So mulching is the second practice that we follow religiously. We do, you know, as far as possible, we just keep live mulching, minimum dead mulching. And even if you look at this, this is the weed at the farm. Now, we do not practice a lot of weeding if our main crop has grown above our, you know, if the main crop has grown above the weed. When the main crop and the weed are of the same level, we do some weeding. But once the main crop has gone up, we do not do any weeding after that. Because your weeds also act as natural soil covers. You have weeds of different monocot weeds, dicot weeds. They also fix nitrogen back into the soil. So, you know, weed is actually beneficial. Just that it shouldn't interfere with your main crop. So this is the second practice that we follow. Then from here, like I said, we do a lot of intercropping. We started by practicing two intercrops or three intercrops. And from there, we've now gone to a food forest model. So I'll just show you a second. This is a second plot of farm, a second experimental plot that we had started, again, quite some while back. Now here we have, we had close to around 8 different crops out here. We had drumsticks, papayas, bananas, tur dal, moong, udit, all your pulses, grains. So this out here.
Fantastic. Ajinkya, you'll be happy to know that our previous session was on food forests and we've been propagating a lot. So this is fantastic. You're showing us a live food forest.
Yeah. So this out here is a lemon. This is a desi lemon. It's called Kagzi Limbu. It's unlike your advanced varieties. Advanced varieties lemons are very big. This lemon is very small in size, but the juice taste is excellent. This is lemon. This is a drumstick tree, a second crop. This is a banana, a third crop. Here we have a papaya. This is a fourth crop. We've already harvested 5-6 crops from this plot. And when after we've harvested the crops, we've taken the remains and we put them back into the soil. So this entire thing is mulch. You know, if you look at this, this is all weed, which we had removed and we put it back into the soil. So this is like, this is a real organic matter.
Wow.
And this is layers and layers of mulch. Only thing is, you should not do extreme mulching. The logic is, you know, inside this, deep inside, it should not turn anaerobic. You should have mulch, but the air should be able to play through. So one feet or a half a feet of mulch is okay. But if you're piling in a lot of mulching and the soil below is turning anaerobic, then that's you do not want that condition to happen with your farm. Okay. This is a food forest. It had turned very dense. We just did some. We've removed all the trees that have stopped fruiting and we're planting new ones. Like I said, a fourth practice that we follow. I've showed all the soil, a first practice. I've showed all mulching, how we do. I've showed all intercropping out here as a food forest. A fourth practice that we follow is this. You know, are these trees? compound trees. So we've planted trees that grow tall, that cut the winds, and you know, when you're farming and you're doing compound trees, you also got to keep in mind that these trees, you know, sunlight should be able to penetrate through them. Because what happens is, if I plant trees that are very, you know, whose branches grow very far off and sunlight does not penetrate through them, then these trees will come up right till here, and then I cannot plant anything on this line. So for this entire running line, I will be losing this opportunity to plant crops if my compound trees are very dense. So this works very fine. This is, in Marathi, we call it suru. It's called Australian pine. This grows up to 60 to 90 feet in height. It grows very fast. Yeah, Casuarina, somebody said. Yeah. So one border is Casuarina, one border is bamboo. But these block the wind in February, March, April, when it gets very hot in around our area. This creates a microclimate inside the farm. So there'll be a minimum temperature drop of 3 to 4 degrees. And also you have a lot of bird population sitting on this, which help you in a pest management again. So amazing. This is mulch again, a lot of mulching.
Amazing, because it's really
so this plot
discussing on the principles on food forest, very interesting, because there was a lot of discussion in one of the platforms on whether trees, you know, such thick trees should be there in farms or not, because they stop sunlight from reaching the crops. So you just about answered that question beautifully.
Yeah, so if you look at these leaves of this suru, these leaves are not thick. You know, it's just like a stem. So the sunlight will fall right till its neck, right till the tree trunk. So that's how. So these trees make sense. So this is the fourth practice that we follow. We do a lot of compound trees to create a microclimate. Again, this was some 8-9 intercrops that we had. I'll take you to a third plot, which we've just planted. That has even more crops. Also, like I said, you know, what are we planting? We're planting the indigenous varieties. So let's say, if I'm planting papayas, now, when you're doing organic farming and you're doing indigenous cropping, you will have a drop in productivity. Like if you see these papayas here, these are the indigenous variety papayas. Now, in this variety, you will have male trees and female trees as a farmer when you're planting it. Now, this is a male tree. A male tree will only have flowers. It will not fruit, while a female tree will fruit. Now, if I was doing the advanced variety or the hybrid variety, which is that Taiwan 786, in that case, every tree is a female. Every tree bears a fruit. So my productivity is almost twice, you know, depending on whatever my male-female ratio is. Like this is a male papaya. This will only have trees, only have flowers. It won't fruit. So yes, as an organic farmer, you will have low productivity depending on different crops. Similarly, you know, what we're doing with wheat, we plant the indigenous variety of wheat called as Khapli or Emmer wheat. It has lower productivity, but as a crop, as a food, it is more medicinal. You know, it has less gluten. Your body can digest it. The advanced variety of wheat is something which our body cannot digest. You know, it stays back in your stomach as gluten. So these varieties, you know, there are two ways to look at it. One is from farming, and one is when you're consuming it. The consumer, the customer who's consuming it, its effect on his health. So these crops, as a farmer, don't make more sense to grow because they give you very less productivity. It's a challenge to grow them. But as you know, this is the best food that anybody can consume. It's medicinal in nature.
As a matter of fact, Ajinkya, in our first natural farming session, where Sanjay Patilji had also come in, who has one of the biggest, movements going in Maharashtra on Desi Beej. He coined a term called nutrition per acre versus production per acre, or productivity per acre. And I really like that term, because today we are all talking about the fact that we need nutrition, not just more. It's like a stomach. You can keep filling in your stomach with grains or food of any kind, or you can take just a little bit of greens and a few proteins, etc. And that is more important for us, for our body, than actually filling it up with lots of calories and carbs, etc. Right?
Correct. So a lot of people, you know, they tend to compare prices of organic food, and they say, why is organic food costly? A very common question that it comes to a lot of organic farmers. And, you know, it is also because people just compare food in kg or in mass. You know, they're comparing 1 kg of pomegranates versus 1 kg of organic versus the inorganic pomegranates or whatever. So when you compare in mass, of course, it might seem costlier. But like you said, when you compare in terms of nutrition, what is my nutrition in this 1 kg and what is my nutrition in that 1 kg? You know, you'll then understand that it is not costly.
Right. Absolutely.
Yeah. So we've come to a third plot of the farms.
In a farm which has a soil, which you have, the food actually turns into really into medicine. You know what? When they say food is medicine, not all food is medicine. But food which is grown with soils like this definitely has huge medicinal value. Fantastic.
Correct. So now we have people taking supplements, vitamin supplements, nutritional supplements. But the real nutrition, the real nutrients comes through your food, you know. And for food, for nutrients to come in the food, you need microorganisms in the soil. They are the ones who release the nutrients from the soil and make it available in the available format for the plant. So, yeah, you were saying about food and nutrition. This is a third plot of the farms. Here we've gone into, this is just planted new. We've planted close to 15-20 fruits. So this is coconut here that we've planted. Then this is papaya here that we've planted.
They're all babies right now.
They're babies right now. Some have grown big. So here this is sitafal. This has grown big.
Yeah.
This out here is brinjal. Mm-hmm. Along the line we've planted this dill leaves.
So
this is again.
One thing which is coming to me is this a
different crop?
Do you do no tilling here?
There are plots where we've not done tilling for a very long time. But when the plot is new, we till it once, and then after the tilling is over, then we don't till it as much as possible. We don't till it.
Okay.
This year is ginger. So ginger has been planted along this. So now I've showed you papaya, sitafal, mangoes, coconuts, dill leaves, coriander is what we've planted. We've got ginger on this bed. And it's jamun. So yeah, we've planted multiple varieties, different crops. Here we've planted coriander. In this entire line is coriander. In the middle line is ginger. On the alternate lines are fruit trees. So we have 3 month crops, 6 month crops. We have leafy vegetables. We have fruits, grains, pulses. So you know all of this.
What is the planning behind how you plant these, you know, how you choose to plant what with each other, when, etc.? Is there some planning behind your cropping? That's what I think some of our viewers might want to know.
Yeah, so it's a very simple logic. Trees that grow very tall, if you're looking at jamun tree, you're looking at mango trees. So, you know, when they grow tall, their branches grow high. So they will need a lot of space tomorrow. Down the line. So you plant them at a larger distance, whatever. 15 by 15. Then between them, you plant trees that don't grow as tall. It could be a chikku, it could be papayas, it could be drumstick, which do not grow as tall as them. And then from there, you plant smaller trees. Then you can plant your 3 month vegetables, your leafy vegetables. Yeah, so I mean, that's how. You keep in mind that they're going to grow tomorrow. And when they grow, then you will have a lot of space required for them. So, sure. Yeah, but there are a lot of models available on what to grow with what.
Do you do any companion planting, for example, or things which grow together very well? And those which are better nitrogen fixers? How do you...
Correct. So, you know, what turns out to be more practical is you first need to understand in your geography, around your area, whether it's a drought area, drought prone area, hardy area, you know, you need to understand what are the crops that are being grown for the last many years. And, you know, start planting or start intercropping from there. So, like I said, we shifted our cropping pattern from something that required a lot of water to crops that require less water. So then for us, the options were, you know, to grow crops that require the least amount of water. So it could be pomegranates, it could be drumsticks, it could be pulses, grains, kharif crop, rabi crops, 3 months, 6 months. And you know, that way you get more clarity. Instead of seeing ideally which crops are good companions, you got to choose between what grows in your area, what is the season now, and then planting that seasonal crop.
And a lot of people are noticing that you're walking barefoot on the soil.
So that's a practice that we follow. We just love walking barefoot on the soil. Whenever we come to the farms, the feeling of having a sole against the soil is a different feeling in itself. Helps you to also earth your energies. But no reason like that. Not for energies or not for anything like that. But then we just love walking barefoot on the soil. It's
and it
it's just fun.
It doesn't hurt the insects and like what Jains say, right? That as much as possible to avoid hurting these many.
Yeah, it doesn't. If you can grow to that level of consciousness, wherein you also thinking of while walking, am I killing an ant while am I killing some microbiology while I'm walking around? But yeah, we're just walking because we walk barefoot because the soil is healing. It feels good. And that's the one thing we're working with day and night over a period of time. Soil is what we're thinking. Soil is what we're trying to develop. So yeah, we love walking barefoot. So like this, I'll show you now. So this is, you know, sugarcane dried leaves. We've picked up this from farmers. And we just kept it in the farm. So this has been more than 4-5 months. But whenever the time is right, when I think we need some mulching, I'll pick this up from here and I'll keep it laid around the farm. So whatever we can find in terms of mulching, in terms of even if it's cow dung, cow urine, that is gold for us. That is what we keep at the farms.
Awesome.
This all is again, you know, these are all intercropping plots. I'll just show you this again. Yeah. Again, a lot of mulching here. Here also we have drumsticks. There's banana here. There's papayas there.
Love your farm.
So well, one board of...
Completely love your farm.
Yeah. So, you can never get it 100% right. Now, this is what happens with desi papayas. Your indigenous papayas will never grow very tall. Your desi grow tall, and when they grow very tall, you know, they will topple down. They'll fall over, and then you've got to restart in planting them.
Right.
Now, I showed you one board of the farms, which was Suru, or which was your Australian pine. The other border is in my farms is this. You know, we've got bamboos around. This is close to 6,000-7,000 bamboo trees we've planted. Even this is a very dense fence that's created here. Even if you look at bamboos, look at the mulching, look at the droppings.
So is this bamboo plantation also meant for an agroforestry, commercial agroforestry purpose?
No, not really. We were just looking at different options. What we can plant around the farm. So we thought while on one side, which is here, while on one side we have your Australian pine, we thought let's experiment with a different one, which is bamboos.
Okay.
So no real planning. We just wanted some variety and we wanted to then compare because we're doing a lot of experiments. So we thought just let's plant different varieties and check how they behave.
Right. Just a couple of things for water. I don't know whether you're going to come to water later, but I was curious to know whether you have any ponds or small water, what should I say, provisions for water.
Harvesting, yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. So if you ask us, we started with, we have two wells at the farm, three wells in fact. And then we've also created a pond where we harvest close to 4 crore liters of water. It's a simple pond, which we've taken it down just to 15 feet. There is no paper lining.
We just lost you for a moment. Yeah.
We just either start up below the rock, start up and stop. Yeah. Of bore wells and a pond that can harvest close to 4 liters of rainwater, 4 crore liters of rainwater.
Wow.
But if you ask us about water harvesting, you know, the best, like I said, fertile soils are actually the best harvesters of water. That is one. And also second is, if you're really looking at harvesting water smartly, is choosing crops that require less water. Because no matter, you know, how many wells I have, what bigger pond I have, if I'm going to plant a crop that requires the water requirement is very high, it's going to be difficult. There's never going to be enough water for me.
Right.
So, you know, this is one well we have at the farms.
And very interestingly, in the afternoon when we have a session today with Babulal Dahiyaji from Madhya Pradesh, he's a seed saver. Yesterday he was sharing with us that many of the desi varieties actually really save and conserve on water compared to the hybrid varieties. And it's one very big reason to actually have desi varieties also.
Correct. So which is why we totally shifted our cropping patterns from the crops you are planting before, like sugarcane and bananas, to then coming to these crops which require less water, which are more seasonal in nature. By the way, this is a small office at the farm.
Uh-huh.
It's an old mango tree, and this is where we do, you know, after the farm work, whatever online work we have or even otherwise the planning that we do, this is a where we sit and just kind of finish our work out in the nature.
Wow.
Yeah, so you were talking about water management. We use drip irrigation everywhere. We do not water by flow. Everywhere we have drips and a lot of drip irrigation.
So, is this the natural drip irrigation, which is you by ropes, etc.? Have you tried that method? Using ropes for drip irrigation, or are these plastic pipes?
No, so these are, you call them laterals. These are laterals. In this, you have two options. You can either lay them on the surface, or you can also have them 6 inches below the soil.
Mm-hmm.
So you can have subline just on the top. So we use these laterals which are on the surface.
Okay.
On the surface of the soil. Now this, I'll just show you all this. We have now just ordered close to 2,000 trees. We had some good rains in the last month. And we started planting more trees. We just called for a truckload of trees from a nursery in Rajmundry. This is close to 250 or 300 trees of bamboo. Like I showed you know, the bamboo experiment was successful. So we've called for more bamboo trees. We want to start, you know, the other borders of the farm, wherever we can find space, we're going to plant these out there. We've called for more lemon trees, lemon saplings. These are all, again, the desi nimbu saplings. This is close to 200 odd saplings of nimbu. That was of bamboo. This is of tamarind. We've got some, another 200 odd trees of tamarind, all desi varieties, desi tamarind. This out here is mango. Another 100 trees, 100 odd saplings of mangoes that we're planting at the farm. From there, we then come to jackfruit. This is funnus or jackfruit. This is also close to 100 odd trees we're going to be planting in some days from today. When you go back.
So have you done this based on what you feel to be the greater demand in terms of in food?
Demand. This is Mosambi. We've never really looked at what the customer, what the you know, what sells in the market. We are only looking at what grows, what is good for our soil, what is more hardy for the soil. And when that fruits, when that harvests, then we decide what to do with it. Like, for example, we grow a lot of groundnuts at the farm. Groundnuts are also hardy, they're seasonal. Once the groundnuts are ready, then we decide whether we make cold pressed oil out of it, or we make peanut butter out of it, or we make peanut chikki out of it, or we make peanut chutney out of it. Similarly with all the other crops. So we grow what is right for our soil, what is right for our area, what grows easily in our soil, in our geography. And so yeah, we are soil up. Not really looking at what works in the market and then planting it in the soil.
Processing unit inside your farm?
No, it's not inside the farm. We have a small processing unit which is at our old Vada. We stay in a place called as Vada. It's an old house, a Maharashtrian house, which is made of just wood and wood and stone. And all the processing happens inside that Vada. So the processing doesn't happen at the farm. I was just showing you the new trees. So while I showed you bamboo, lime, mangoes, tamarind, this is jackfruit here. This is peru here, guava. Again, out there we've got jamun. So we are trying to create, I mean, we've already created a forest, food forest, but we're trying to make it, you know, more diversity, more fruits.
Superb.
And then want to more medicinal plants also.
Superb. This is awesome. Wonderful. This is like bringing us to life. You know, Ajinkya, it was a very intuitive thing because on our platform, we have many, many farmers. And while I did not know you personally, it was very intuitive for me to connect with you. And I think what caught my attention, apart from so much which I keep seeing about Two Brothers, what actually caught my attention is when you use the word food forest. And I said, yes, we have
okay,
to.
Okay.
So how many farmers are working with you, Ajinkya?
Correct. So now, you know, while farming is one part of it, managing the farm is another important aspect. We have kept, you know, we've got two different plots at the farm. This is a 14-acre to a 15-acre plot. There is one main manager here. And whenever we need people, you know, either for weeding or for harvesting, or like what I just show you.
Yeah, we're losing you a little bit.
Yeah. So like you can see these ladies out here who are working at the farm.
Yes.
Whenever we need any extra labor, we get them from the nearest town. But
okay.
Otherwise, there is one main manager. Okay. His main job is to be at the farm every day and to look at the water management in particular and the crops, insects, pests. While the real thing like planning what to do, which crops, which are the intercrops, when to plant, what to do, which nursery to get the the seeds from, which farmer to get the seeds from. That is something which we decide and a basic manager at the farm. So yeah, you're asking about farm management.
Yeah, absolutely. Because
so two farms, two main managers.
And, yeah, please go ahead.
Yeah, so two different farms at different locations, two farm managers, who are full time, and then the temporary labor as and when that is required comes to the farm. You were also asking about drip irrigation. So you know this is how we utilize water efficiently. So these are the drip lines into the farm. Yes, we also had somebody who had given us some boxes of honeybees. I'll try showing you that. Although it's deep inside. So I don't know if you can see this. There's some boxes here.
Not yet. I think there's a little bit of lag. So, there's a little lag. So, it might
No problem.
Take us some time to see it. Yes. It's fascinating that you've been able to show us your farm, you know, while walking through the farm. You know, we've been having network problems of people sitting in the houses, and you managed to do this right on a farm, and that itself is quite a feat, you know.
So already the connectivity at the farms in most rural areas is now better than connectivity in the cities. There's also a lot of data around this. So it's made everything easier. So even sitting from a farm, you can do a lot of work online. And we've experienced it ourselves. We go to Pune, we go to Bombay. But yeah, the connectivity here is much better.
That's because there are fewer people, I guess, and fewer communication lines crisscrossing each other. So I think a lot of people want to know the business model which you have set up. So while there are questions around your turnover and profit, I am not going to touch upon that. But I definitely want to want people to understand what is the model which you're running right now. How many people do you hire? How do you manage your cost versus how your customers are able to make this a sustainable and a profit model, really speaking. Have you finished the four pillars you wanted to speak about? I mean, are they done?
Yeah, I'm done with that. So about the soil and then mulching and intercropping and the compound trees and then indigenous seeds. So I'm finished with that. If it comes to, you know, this is something we've experienced. We came down to farming in 2012 to only farm. There was never a plan or a strategy to make a, you know, to do any marketing around this. It was just to be at the farm, be oblivious to everything else around and just enjoy our time spent here. But then in 2012, when our first crop came out, we took it to the local APMC. We sold, we went at a loss. In 2013, same thing happened. And this happened consecutively for the first 4 years. We were not into marketing our produce. We should just take the produce and take it to the nearest mandi, the nearest APMC, sell it out there. And it was never making money, not even being sustainable. We then understood that, you know, if you have to make this sustainable over a period of time, if this is what you want to do for the rest of our lives, we will have to make this commercially viable. And that's when we started reaching out. We wanted to bypass the middlemen, bypass the local mandi. And it happened very instinctively. So what I'm trying to get at is, you know, all the viewers out here asking questions on the turnover and sustainability. I want to make this farmer, you cannot be sustainable by only doing farming. You also need to be marketing your produce. While one of your leg, if you compare it to a bicycle, while one of your leg is while one pedal of your leg is on the farming, you also need to keep one on the marketing aspect. So for us, it happened instinctively. We had papayas in the year 2015 or 16, which we took to the nearest market in Pune. And the rate we were getting for the papayas was just around 4-5 rupees a kg. So we used to observe that, you know, a lot of these fruit sellers stand under these over bridges in cities and were not selling it at the local mandi. We went to one of these over bridges in the city and we spoke with some hand cart vendors out there. And there were close to 7 hand cart vendors. And with them, we started selling on the road. We used to harvest twice a week, take it to these 7 people out there, stand on the road, talk to customers, talk to guys who stopped by, explaining to them why this fruit is different, how we've grown it, our practices in farming. And if we were getting a 4 to 5 rupees in the local mandi, in the local APMCs, there we started getting close to 15 to 17 rupees per kg, which was like, you know, it turned the entire farm profitable. It turned the entire model profitable. And we did this for 7 months selling on the road. And it was then after 4 years that we could, you know, prove that this farming is profitable. From then, I think for the next 2 years, we were selling it with retail chains, with Star Bazaar, with Reliance, with Nature's Basket also. We've sold whatever we produce at the farms. But then, you know, these malls do a lot of grading. And especially as an organic farmer, when you go to them to sell, they are practically rejecting 70 to 75% of your produce. And they're just taking in 20-25%. They want stuff that looks good from the outside. They want stuff that is big in size. It should all look like uniform, like tennis balls on the rack of that mall. And so, you know, having worked with them, we just got a satisfaction that, you know, we're selling. It was not making sense, you know, it was making no sense commercially. So, I remember we had pomegranate.
We're losing
Yeah, we had pomegranates, and we just made a simple Excel sheet form and rotated it on WhatsApp, speaking about how we've grown this pomegranate and the farming practices. And we received a 300 odd orders from Pune and from Bombay. And we made sure, you know, since we were so passionate about farming and the way we've grown it, we wanted to talk about this to the client, to the customer. And those first 300 orders, we went personally to each customer's house and we delivered it to him. And we delivered the pomegranates. We also, you know, kind of spoke, showed with videos, whatever we had, that how we farming, what we doing. And the word of mouth started going around from there. And those 300 customers, you know, today has gone to close to 45, 50,000 customers that we have. And if you're talking in terms of turnover, yeah, if you're talking in terms of turnover, we were, you know, when we started out, we were doing just 20,000 monthly. Just a 2 or 3 lakh rupees in a year to now. I mean, we just recently got a valuation of a multi-million dollars. So it all started like this. You know, we had a tough time finding our way through in the market. So like I said, it was a combination of first, you know, taking a decision, moving out of the city and doing farming full time, then getting the farming model right in terms of what crops to grow, in terms of what seeds to grow, the different practices, and then marketing being one of the most the biggest challenges along the way. So yeah, and while we did all of this, there was no plan, there was no strategy, nothing. It is purely an unfolding over a period of time.
Actually, this is the beauty of organic, that a lot of things come. Like when I plan my training program, I don't even think I plan it, you know, it comes to me intuitively. Just like I mentioned that for me, your name just popped up. Okay, I need to talk to Ajinkya. I don't know whether he knows me and I know him, but I need to talk to him. And so this is the whole space, you know. We don't know what is driving us to do what we are doing, but it is somewhere. I think there's a divine force which, when your heart is pure, your intention is you know, so focused. I think things happen on their own, and that is really about nature. You know, it's not just natural farming. Everything about nature is connection. If you're connected, then nature takes care of you. It will make sure that you always are in abundance, and you know, your consumers are taken care of, your farmers. So I'm now coming to the last part of the section. We are kind of almost at the closure now. And the last part is that you are somewhere also taking care of your worker, you know, people who work for you, farm hands, farmers who work with you, and farmers who are outside your farm. Can you share a little bit more about that? I'm very excited for you to share how you have treated them as stakeholders, and also other farmers, how you can be a beacon for them going forward.
Correct. So when we got to farming in 2012, we had these few staff at the farm. Like I just said, you know, we have one main manager here at both the farms. We have two main, and these are all school dropouts. They're all fourth standard, fifth standard dropouts. One of them was a driver who used to help us with whatever work we had at the farms. And simple guys, naive guys, no education, got to the life of hard work and toiling right from, you know, ever since they could think of, from generations. And when the business started growing green, we first increased all their salaries. And when we got some good valuation, we thought, you know, we were thankful to them somewhere deep within. So we were like, you know, let's give back to them. They've also been a part of, it's not just about these crops and soil and animals. It's also about the human element at the farm. And when we got the valuation, I just spoke about, you know, just a few days back, we had a small function at the farm, and to all the farm staff that have been with us from day one, that have been loyal, that have been a part of the farm, we gifted them shares worth 1 million rupees each, so close to 10 lakh rupees of shares each gifted to them. They're worth 1 million rupees today. I another 5-10 years down the line, we just hope we could make them multi-millionaires.
Wow. Awesome. And I can't help asking this question. Have you opened this farm for agro tourism and for children? Is there any plan? I know you're doing work around children and you're teaching children in schools. Do share a little bit about that. I'm sure many people will be inspired listening to your stories. Yes, it is a private limited.
Yeah. So, so we're working with some schools in Pune and in Mumbai. And where we formed organic farming clubs, or the school itself has formed organic farming clubs in the school. And, students are a part of the club right from standard 1 to 10th. It's by the will. And out there, it's a voluntary activity. And then we teach them to grow food in the school as against your artisanal plants. So it could be leafy vegetables. It could be your regular tomatoes, potatoes, normal vegetables. So, yeah, that's an activity we're having at schools. I think this year we just finished a 1 year function with them, and we had some we arranged a function around it where we called some organic farmers and the parents of all these the entire students' parents in the school. We had speakers in the space from Vandana Shiva to some other people working, like you said, even Sanjay was there speaking about different aspects, different topics that cover farming, and exposing this to children, because children are not, in schools they are not really taught about farming, about soil. And like I said, this is so interesting, even for a student who's bright, who's academically ahead. This is that one subject where all your other subjects culminate into. This is actually the denominator of all science that you can think of. So, we thought this is something that students at a young age need to be exposed to, need to be shown. And they can pick up from there then.
Super, wonderful, awesome. So I don't have words, beyond these expressions. Any one last question? How many people are there on the roll is one question. So with this, I really feel we should put a rest to this session. I think it's been a fantastic, literally you've taken us through a journey. Did you answer the question on agrotourism? I was trying to actually forward this.
I skipped that. I skipped that. So we were never interested in agrotourism. We came here to farm, to be at the farm, to be as much to ourselves as possible. And but we've been having a lot of visitors coming over. So we've had close to 6,000 to 7,000 visitors from Maharashtra, from Gujarat, from Karnataka, from Jharkhand, from Lucknow, who've come over to the farms. We don't treat it as a tourism. When farmers come over, we don't charge them for anything. We just share what we do at the farm. There is no module. There is no course. You come, you learn, you ask us questions. We will not teach you anything. You want to learn something, you come, you ask, and you see and you learn. So this is the model we've been keeping. Interestingly, we've also been having a lot of foreigners. People from close to 15, 16 countries have come over to the farm still now. From US, from Germany, France, Italy, Austria. A lot of farmers from there, especially from Italy. Cheesemakers from there who've come over, stayed at the farm. We don't charge anything for the food or the stay, but we make them work at the farm for 8 hours, 6 to 8 hours compulsory. So we have never really looked at it as an agrotourism thing, though we have a lot of people coming over at the farms.
Do you have a small organic kitchen or something? I mean, where people eat? Have you thought of that or done that? Or
yes, so it is our house itself, which is a wada. When you have a tourism, when you have a concept like an agrotourism and all, then you need to entertain the visitors. The onus comes on you. Whereas here, somebody who's really interested in farming, in soil, in we would prefer to have the most serious crowd coming over, while we also love children. I mean,
right. Okay, wonderful. So this is beautiful. It's a lovely journey, right in the middle of Ajinkya and Satyajit's two brothers' farms. I think you've inspired a lot of people today. I can say this very, very safely without a word. And I'm sure there are going to be demand for lots of sessions going forward, Ajinkya. I know your time is precious as a farmer, but as and when we feel that there are a whole lot of people who need to be inspired, we'll reach out to you. There may be, of course, specific questions which are very technical, so we'll see later how we can you know, help address them. Vidya, yeah, I think people are using the same words, very much inspiring, very, yeah. So a lot of questions coming in. Let me just check if there is anything which I can have a debate for with Classmates reverses everything. Yeah, so the people who believe that organic doesn't work, and you kind of reverse that argument for them. But it requires smart marketing. I must say that people like you, and this is what Bhumija actually supports, people like you who are farmers and yet smart marketers, you know, with having learned all your lessons. And we need models where of leaders like you. You know, you're not just an entrepreneur, you're not just an agripreneur, you're not just a farmer, but you are really an inspiring leader. And to me, that's the kind of stuff which we need in farming desperately right now. Okay. And what I really liked also, and I'm sure others will agree, is that your farming is not driven by money. And I personally, I'm very concerned about a whole lot of youngsters coming into farming, thinking that overnight they're going to make money out of, you know, organic farming. No, it's a lot of hard work. It's a lot of instinctive work, and money abundance comes when you give 100% to it and you do it right. Okay. And you understand the consumer also, give him or her the best, connect with them. So the connection is really both ends. So thank you very much, Ajinkya. We really, really thoroughly enjoyed. I have so many questions popping up in my head, but I'm going to refrain right now. What we are going to do now is end the session by saying that all the pillars he's talked about, we've tried to touch them in our natural farming sessions. Yes, not as much as we would have liked to, but I think Ajinkya kind of really sums it up and brings it out to in the real world for you. We are going to end this whole series with the Desi Beach session. So please be there for the Desi Beach session. We have some amazing Desi Beach savers from across India who are coming for the session. Let's honor them, because I believe really it's about honoring them and their work, and also learning how we can propagate it further, use and propagate it further, and end with how we can market traditional varieties. Because it is one thing to grow things desi in a desi way, but there are so many varieties which people are not even habituated to having. So how do you, like he talked about khapli, many of us never tasted khapli in our life, right? So similarly, there are lots of rice varieties, lots of millets, lots of wheat varieties, which none of us have actually tasted. A lot of other vegetables, fruits, etc. We need to learn to diversify our tastes and spread the word to people to taste different things and not just stick to our known palate, so to speak. So with this, I'm going to end it. And please bring as many people as possible for the Desi Beach session. It's an open session. So we are most welcome to even share the link with as many people who can benefit from it. Thank you, Ajinkya.
Yeah, I would just like to say thanks to everybody for being over. Thank you for your interest in farming, in crops, in plants. You know, this is one of the most satisfying hobbies, interests, careers you can ever boil down to. It is very subtle. It is very satisfying. And just a thank you for having an interest in this area.
Yeah, thank you. Yes, Ajinkya, I completely agree. Those people who really connect with it are really people who are moving into the conscious space of nature conservation. And so I think, yes, we need to thank them that they have moved up many notches. So continue to propagate this. Ajinkya, you are on many platforms, and hopefully Amar Ujala will also be covering this. It will, you know, spread across several states, Hindi-speaking states, and we will see how to really take these. These are wonderful conversations. I mean, where can you have something as valuable as what Ajinkya has shared? Or, you know, what we had in beekeeping today morning. I mean, it is like just too stupendous even for me. So thank you, and we'll keep sharing ahead.